Good morning. Sinusitis, tonsillitis, breathing difficulties, ear and nose infections. Today's Health Hour is dedicated to ENT issues. Join us at 11 a.m. where senior ENT consultant and surgeon Dr. Kalpana Nagpal is going to share us life-changing ENT care tips. So ask your questions in the live session. See you there, 11 a.m. Good morning. Sinusitis, tonsillitis, breathing difficulties, ear and nose infections. Today's Health Hour is dedicated to ENT issues. Join us at 11 a.m. where senior ENT consultant and surgeon Dr. Kalpana Nagpal is going to share us life-changing ENT care tips. So ask your questions in the live session. See you there, 11 a.m.
It's always been there, standing between you and your health. A wall. Between a pain that won't disappear and a doctor who magically appears. Between a long wait on a hospital bench and staying right where you are, at home. Between finding yourself out of medicines and finding them at your doorstep. whatever the time. Between years of health records all over the place and all your records in one organized access from anywhere place. Between your current regimen and the recommended routine. The wall. We don't need it anymore. Say hello to Apollo 24/7. This is India's largest end-to-end omni-channel healthcare ecosystem, designed to touch more lives than ever before and delivering its promise in three important ways. One, listen. Talk to us anytime from anywhere. We've got 7,000 doctors and 30,000 healthcare professionals listening. Two, advice. We'll give you expert advice, advice you can rely on, because it comes from India's number one healthcare provider. Three, assist. We bring you India's largest health network of pharmacies, clinics, hospitals, and health insurance experts. 20 million people already trust us for their care, and a further 50,000 people are discovering this every day. Apollo 24/7. Expertise is for everyone.
Namaste, namaskar, and welcome to Apollo 24/7's Health Hour. Today's show, we are inviting a senior consultant robotic surgeon from Department of ENT Head and Neck Surgery, Apollo Hospitals, Delhi. One and only Kalpana Nagpal Garu will join us very shortly. We are going to talk about ENT issues and we are going to take up your questions in the live. I'm so happy to have her. We are going to invite her onto the show. The show is going to have a health quiz where you can participate and win prizes from Apollo 24/7. Stay on till the end because we are going to give away discount vouchers and gift coupons. Please stay till the end and you can avail the discount offers as well. So ladies and gentlemen, let's get into the show. Thank you so much for joining us today because Apollo 24/7 brings all of Apollo together into one app that is Apollo 24/7. You can consult doctors, you can book appointments, you can buy medicines, you can book tests, and you can actually save records. And so much that you can do, all that platform offers can be availed through Apollo 24/7. And the best part is become a circle member too. Once you become a circle member of Apollo 24/7, you have multiple benefits. Let me show you a video of what you could do with circle membership. Here's a video on Apollo circle membership plan. So this is the Apollo's and once you download Apollo 24/7, you can upgrade to the circle plan by just, you know, you can select the circle plan which suits your budget, which suits your requirement. The introductory offer and the base plan of Apollo 24/7 circle plan is just ₹49 for 2 months. It is as simple as that. So I request you all to download Apollo 24/7 app and then upgrade to Circle program as well. Let's start today's show. But before I start today's show and invite our guests, I want to thank all the participants who are here watching the show live on their YouTube channels. And physically, there are two communities participating from Hyderabad. I would like to thank all these community resident welfare associations and all the participants who have joined us live from the communities of
Aditya's Imperial Heights and Seven Hills. Thank you so much for joining us, and please do ask your queries in the live session. I'll take up them with Dr. Kalpana Nagpal, who's going to join us very shortly. So ladies and gentlemen, it's my privilege and honor to welcome the expert ENT surgeon, Dr. Kalpana Nagpal, who's a senior consultant in robotic surgeon, Department of ENT Head and Neck Surgery in the Prasad Apollo Hospitals, Delhi. And her profile goes on really, really very long. She's the leading robotic ENT surgeon in India with over 24 years of experience. She specializes in endoscopic surgeries in ENT, tumors of head and neck, robotic surgeries for snoring disorders, throat cancer, thyroid, and she's done more than 200 robotic and more than 2000 microscopic surgeries, and is also a mentor proctor for robotic head and neck surgery training in India. I also want to mention specifically that she is the only ENT robotic head and neck surgeon available in North India. She is the senior registrar at Department of ENT at Deen Dayal Upadhyay Hospital, Delhi and Apollo Hospitals. She's done several publications in national and international journals. Let me welcome Dr. Kalpana Nagpal once again to the show. Namaste, ma'am. Welcome to the show.
Thank you so much, Jansi.
Thank you. And just as a bit of an introduction, other than her profile of medical records that she holds, ma'am can speak multiple languages, not just Indian languages, but also international languages like Swahili and Pashto. Anything that I've missed? The international languages?
Yes, you're right.
So
right.
She can speak Telugu, Tamil. She understands Malayalam, Hindi very fluently.
Telugu, Punjabi, Pashto.
China. Yes, sure. So she can be consulted online on Apollo 24/7. You can speak the language that you choose with her. Really wonderful to see you, ma'am. And thank you so much for your wonderful time.
Thank you so much for the kind introduction.
Yes. Ma'am, as I was reading about you and your profile, I understand that robotic head and neck surgeons are very rare. And endoscopic kind of work, the surgeries that you have performed are very rare in India. And you have accomplished this task in multitudes of numbers. What is the difference between robotic and an endoscopic surgery, ma'am? When who requires what?
Right. Actually, the era has changed now. Technology has given us a lot of advantages. Technology has changed medicine and surgery. So since the time of invent of endoscopes, we almost gave up traditional methods, because endoscopic yes. surgeries were also like minimally invasive surgeries. Now that robots have come, now robotic assisted surgeries are also minimally invasive surgeries, but with much added advantages. There are clearly patient advantages and surgeon advantages. And those surgeon advantages are also indirectly patient advantages. Like, for example, patient advantages are like no cosmetic disfigurement, no blood loss. The patient can be, it's only short stay in the hospital. And the anesthesia required is much less. For some of the cases, this like cancer cases, radiotherapy and chemotherapy can be avoided, and so their side effects can be avoided. And there are many, many, many newer treatments that we're doing, because the indications have been expanding. And so there are no external scars. And, the surgeon also gets 10 times the magnification. We're operating on the 3D vision. So crucial structures are not damaged. And the dissection is so precise, because the depth magnification is so good. And so that is why I said these advantages for the surgeon also become indirectly advantages for the patient as well. And the surgeon is sitting comfortably on a chair and doing it, so better ergonomics and no fatigue, and even the tremors are eliminated. So robot-assisted surgeries can be, performed even by a 70 or 80-year-old. So I advise all the youngsters to take up this field, and probably then there's no retirement.
Yeah, and I think that way you have paved a path, and you've been the mentor for many and inspiration for the next generations to come, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, well, while I was reading your profile and while I was going through, I understood that you have done thyroidectomies without a scar.
Yeah, that's
true. How is that possible?
Well, now, first of all, robot-assisted surgeries, you can access any inaccessible areas otherwise. Now, human arms are basically having limited movements, because it's actually, because we are humans. So the wristed movements are, limited in a certain angle, like you can move it front or back, or you can move it sideways, but you cannot move it 180 degrees.
Exactly.
So all the limitations that humans have, that is now taken advantage by the robotic arms. So all of these steps that we perform is basically same, like we follow the same anatomical landmarks and same surgical steps. It's just that the robotic arms are performing instead of us. And so they can reach all the inaccessible areas and they can move. I mean, there's no limitation in the movement. It can be 180 degree free movement. And so for thyroids also, what I'm doing. So like even neck dissections can be performed like that. So either in the armpit or the incision can be much behind inside the hairline, which means hidden. So yes, so much good for the patient. Yeah, so much.
Yes. So that is one that we understand that you use the robotic the arm that is going through and you reach the place. But there are certain other surgeries that, as you were mentioning earlier, the surgeries which are related to head and neck and above the neck where endoscopic procedures are used?
Yes, very much. Actually, endoscopic surgeries have been advancing again, you know, from the last 10 years. Every year there have been advances. We do coablation endoscopic surgeries where there are a lot of coablation procedures done. It's a plasma technology where you're cutting and along with it, a good hemostasis is achieved. Just like even in robotics, hemostasis is so good. While you're cutting the tissues, the hemostasis is taken care of. And that's where there's no blood loss. And coablation technology along with the endoscopic, we do a lot of skull-based surgeries like anterior skull-based, lateral skull-based, which means we're repairing brain fluid leaks even through the nose, without giving any cuts on the brain or the skull. Similarly, we remove pituitary tumors from inside the nose. So there are a lot of endoscopic procedures that we can do now, which do not need otherwise, you know, those extensive brain surgeries.
Wonderful, ma'am. As I'm speaking to you, I can see that the YouTube chat box is buzzing with a lot of questions. I can see that people are saying hello to you and your followers are also here.
Hi to all.
Yes. And a lot of them are asking about ENT ailments like sinusitis, tinnitus, common allergies and headaches. I'll come to them a little while later. But are there any ailments that are ENT related, which commonly people try to say avoid and ignore, but eventually may or might lead to certain dangers or complications? Are there any of such issues that we need to...
Yes, there are many such issues. For example, in diabetic patients and in chronic kidney disease patients, there could be nasal complaints like sudden loss of smell or nasal obstruction, meaning blockage from one side of the nose or even both sides of the nose. Or there can be blurring of vision along with these symptoms, or there could be some discharge from the nose. And these symptoms are not to be ignored because they could be fungal sinusitis that is indolent, that the patient hasn't even, not even aware of it. And if he or she doesn't present on time, then the fungal sinusitis can lead to complications like even loss of vision or even cerebral complications, meaning brain complications like meningitis, etc. Or they could be even fatality, like patients can die within 6 months because there are conditions like mucormycosis, which is a dangerous fungal condition, which is seen in most of these immunocompromised patients, like patients on steroids or patients having diabetes or patients who are having cancers or kidney disease. In these people, the immunity is down, and so they can have these serious fungal infections. So this is one of them. Similarly, if a patient develops sudden loss of hearing, not many times what's happening is patients come to us after a month or two. And that's the time, you do not have any treatment options. You'll have to tell them, only ask them to go for hearing aids, etc. But if they present within 2 weeks or even earlier, then they have very good treatment options. Like we give some injections in the eardrum and the sudden loss is completely recovered. So these kind of things people are not aware of. So people have to present on time. So similarly, there could be some mouth ulcer which is there, which is a painless mouth ulcer inside the throat. It can be in the cheek or on the tongue or on the tonsil or anywhere else in the throat. And, patient may not be presenting on time and it could be a cancer. So, people usually reach you only when there is a painful condition. So painful condition people think is more serious, whereas I want to tell all my patients that painless conditions are more serious. So if you see anything altered, like altered voice or any ulcer or patch or swelling in the neck, like it could be a lymph node, which is actually representing some of the serious illness like lymphoma or cancer. So please, please do present on time. So anything new in your body, in your ear, nose, throat, and head and neck, these are some of the indicators. Like, for example, there could be tinnitus in the ear, you know, ringing sound in the ear. And there could be a brain tumor, which is actually causing this. That's called a caustic tumor. So that is why any sign of...
That's my advice. Yes, ma'am. So as you were talking, you were mentioning about cancers. So the throat cancers especially, is there a time or a particular way of screening for detecting these cancers of throat?
Yes, absolutely. Now, you know, first of all, people have to know what are the underlying causes. You know, in North India, a lot of people consume tobacco, you know, tobacco chewing as well as smoking. And these are the underlying risk factors. Well, alcohol can also be a risk factor. And apart from that, you all of you would be surprised to know that sleep apnea can be the underlying cause. People suffering from sleep apnea can be having 20 times more risk of developing cancers. So do not ignore your snoring at all. Yes, a lot of people do not know that it's the root cause for several disorders. Now, with advances in methods, you know, like even if, as I said, if there is hoarseness, which is persisting beyond a week, or if there is, you know, trismus, meaning difficulty in opening the mouth completely, or if there is a ulcer, or there is a, you know, swelling in the neck or anything abnormal that if you've seen a bulging of the eye or, you know, nose getting blocked on one side or there is persistent, you know, a polyp-like thing in the ear. So these can be actually symptoms of a cancer. Now, with the advance of endoscopic and camera, you know, assisted device methods, even in the outpatient, a lot of procedures can be done in the outpatient. We could show the patient whatever we are seeing, like in the sense, if there is a tumor or a lesion on the vocal cord, even the attendants who are coming with the patient can all see it on the screen. And then even biopsies can be done in the OPD. So a lot many procedures now that earlier could be only performed in the operation theater now can be performed even in the outpatient. So we have very good endoscopic systems like rigid endoscopes, flexible endoscopes, and with biopsy channels. And also one important thing is human papilloma virus. People, this is another very important condition which is responsible for oral cancers and oropharyngeal cancers.
So as we think HPV is related to cervical cancer, it also has one, few of the strains do have trace to throat cancer, no ma'am?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah. So that's about cancer. But one simple thing, which seems simple, but people might ignore it, nose bleeding. Quite often we do see a lot of people who have complaints of nose bleeding. But advanced technologies, is it something to be taken care of, something serious hai kya, or what are the advanced technologies of taking care of nosebleed?
First of all, nosebleeding in different age groups, the causes could be different. Mm-hmm. Now, yes, I like to highlight few things. For example, nosebleeding in teenagers. There is a condition called angiofibroma. It's a vascular tumor which is present in the backside of the nose. And it can bleed like hell, you know, sometimes initially it presents only with recurrent minor episodes of bleeding. But if any teenager has bleeding, one should go to the ENT surgeon to get this tumor ruled out, because if angiofibroma starts growing, it can grow into, you know, different adjacent areas of the nose and nasopharynx, and then the surgery becomes more difficult. But with the advances in technique, of course, with endoscopic surgeries, you know, there is no morbidity. We are able to remove the entire tumor with the endoscope. But this is one of the causes. Similarly, nose bleeding in elderly, they can be due to tumors inside the nose. Tumors in the nose and nasopharynx are very common. And people do not know this. And similarly, in otherwise, you know, there could be primary causes and secondary causes, which means there could be underlying conditions like kidney disease or hypertension or other vascular diseases where, you know, there is some coagulation profile derangement, or they can be kidney disease, or they can be local lesions inside the nose itself. You know, there could be a mass inside the nose, like an inverted papilloma, or there could be any other conditions inside the nose, because I cannot mention too many medical terms. It's a common public listening to us. So, but what I'm saying is a local thorough examination is required to see if the cause of the nasal bleeding is due to the nose or it's due to a systemic problem. But everything can be fixed, because as we have newer advanced treatments. I had recently a gynecologist came to me, and you know, she had been through several hospitals, several doctors, recurrent episodes of bleeding. In such cases, we have even advanced methods of treatment called sphenopalatine artery ligation. If this is, of course, this is not required for everyone in the beginning, but if the common treatments are failed, then we do this, and then that's, you know, causes permanent resolution. So that is why it's important to see what is the cause and then fix them with the latest advanced treatments.
Right, ma'am. Ma'am, I think this is the time that I should start diving into the questions, because there are way too many questions today and a lot of people are watching us live today. So I would definitely want to take up their questions.
Sure.
They sound very simple and very common. I think everybody is suffering, and that's the reason why they are here to ask you their questions.
Sure, ma'am.
How many other questions that we can take today? We will take these questions. Rest can consult ma'am on Apollo 247's app. Ma'am, the first question that I would want to ask is Mr. Vishwanath Agarwal. My wife snores in the sleep. Her nose bone is slightly bent. Breathing difficulty in right nasal and minor blockage in the left ear. What can be done?
Yes. Now, if there is persistent nasal obstruction and mouth breathing, and the diagnosis is already there, if there is a trochial bone in the nose, then endoscopic septoplasty is the best method to fix this. And this causes permanent resolution. Now, but it's mentioned, according to some Ames doctor, that there is no nasal bone deviation. Diversion is a wrong word that somebody has typed, that they must have meant no nasal bone deviation by some ENT surgeon in Ames. If that is the reason, I mean, if the bone is in the center, then there could be other causes like nasal valve obstruction. Or there may be something on the backside of the nose that's a nasopharynx that's causing the obstruction. So, I mean, he or she can definitely come to me or any other specialist, ENT specialist, to find out what the cause is. And, you know, there is also a condition called sleep apnea, where the patient is snoring and the nasopharyngeal space or the palatal space may be collapsing now and then, and that may be also causing obstruction. So basically, he or she definitely needs one more evaluation to find out what the cause is.
Yes, so Mr. Vishwanath, your question is answered. Ma'am, I would want to take up a lot of sinusitis questions which are individually asked, but most of them are asking about sinusitis. For example, Divya is asking which medicine should one take for sinus headache. Then, yes, a lot of people have asked sinus kick questions, ma'am.
Okay.
What would you suggest for sinusitis?
Right. As people think, you know, it's not like mathematics, this headache, this sinus headache, and you just take one pill. No, there are several types of sinusitis and there are several causes for sinusitis. So we need to know if there is a mechanical problem inside the nose which is obstructing the drainage of the sinuses, or if there is a ciliary deficiency, meaning the cilia, the little hair-like cells in the cells, where, you know, if there is any deficiency in that, or if there is any mucus abnormality, that is increased viscosity of the mucus, that, you know, the mucus is not able to drain off easily. Or, you know, there can be many other reasons for sinusitis, even in whether it is immunocompetent individual or immunosuppressed individual. In either of them, you can have sinusitis. That, like, there is allergic fungal sinusitis, where you see in immunocompetent individuals, which means the immunity is normal, it's just altered. In them also, you can have sinusitis. So we need to know if it is bacterial sinusitis or fungal sinusitis, and the causes and the treatment then. First, most of the cases do very well with medical treatment. So maximum medical management usually works at most cases. Very few need surgeries. And then if there's persistent chronic sinusitis, then we ask them to go for a scan, like a CT scan for the sinuses, and then look at the 3D image and then understand the pathology and then treat them. And then they get permanently cured after endoscopic sinus surgery.
The next question is the ACAD world. My mother is 76-year-old and has hearing problem. She's diabetic and hypertensive. Suggest a suitable treatment.
In a 76-year-old, you know, one of the reasons could be presbyacusis, that is age-induced hearing loss. Apart from that, she has diabetes. Now, diabetes can also cause weakness of the nerves, and that's called central neural loss. In both, in either of the cases or in both of them, if she has presbyacusis related, that's age-related, as well as diabetes-related, hearing aids probably is the solution, but I still would ask for her to go for an audiometry test. It's called pure tone audiometry, where you see the auditory thresholds in different frequencies. And that's when I understand whether hearing aid is an option or not.
Okay, ma'am.
Them do very well with digital hearing aids.
Right, right, ma'am. Next question is from Vijay Kejriwal, who wants to ask, what are the options to minimize snoring problems naturally without any surgery?
Well, to make him understand that snoring can be due to multi-level obstruction in the upper air passage. Now, supposing we consider the upper air passage as a tube, as a pipe. Now, if the pipe is smooth and there is no blockage inside, then the airflow is very smooth. But if there are blockages inside the windpipe or the air pipe, then there is turbulence of the airflow. So obviously, that is the reason you have the sound that's produced, because of the turbulent airflow. That's why snoring happens. So the blockages have to be corrected. In some cases, the tone may be weak. The tone of the upper air muscles may be weak. So the tone needs to be improved. So basically, it is not due to smooth airflow. So snoring, most of the time, apart from advising weight reduction, upper airway passage needs to be corrected. And that's after examining the airway. So it's not like some herbal medicine is going to control snoring.
Okay, ma'am. Namita Gupta has a chronic sinusitis. No blocked since 1 month. Minor relief on taking prescribed medicines like Aswok, etc., etc. Nosekine drops helped for a few hours, but I'm worried. Already have been taking my medicines for a month. Very relief. What can she do further?
The nose blockage, whether it is deviated nasal septum or whether there are polyps or whether it's vasomotor rhinitis or allergic rhinitis, I do not know, because a nasal endoscopy has to be done apart from taking history. Only then I would understand if the inside the bones are swollen or if there is a mechanical obstruction. And then, first of all, one advice from my side is to stop those nasokine drops. Now, drops like Otrivin, Nasivion, Nasokine, these cannot be taken for more than 2 days, and, you know, rarely once in 3 months or once in 6 months, because they have a lot of side effects. Drug-induced, it's called rhinitis medicamentosa. It gives instant magical relief when you use the drops. It's like a magical cure. But at the same time, underlying blockage keeps worsening. So people get hooked to these drops. So my advice is to stop these drops, get a proper evaluation done, and then get it sorted. Some of them may be doing very well with nasal sprays that the doctors prescribe. So they need to go and get them checked first to see what is the cause, whether it is rhinitis or whether any other, inside deformity or any other polyps or any other disease inside.
This is such a valuable piece of advice, ma'am. Thank you so much. That, because you, once you tend to get certain kind of relief, you get hooked on to them.
Yeah, absolutely. There are a lot of patients who come to me who have been giving us history, like, you know, they've been on these nasal drops, dependent on these nasal drops for years and years. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's, yeah, with great difficulty, I keep telling them, you know, it's like poisonous for you. So please throw the drops away, and we'll provide you permanent solution. So there is permanent solution that these people can get.
Very positive and a very positive answer there, ma'am. Yeah. Ashok Talwarji, a question puchte, and followed by, I would want to take up Mr. Vivek Pandey's question as well. Mr. Ashok Talwar says, effect of mouth breathing and snoring on sleep and its prevention. And Mr. Vivek Pandey says, what is the success rate of sleep apnea surgery? So I would want you to take up both the questions, ma'am.
Sure. The first question which you said, you know, snoring and mouth breathing. Now, first of all snorers should understand that there are two types of disorders. One is primary snoring. Primary snoring is snoring without sleep apnea. It is only a social disturbance, which means the spouse has a problem or anybody else.
Family members.
Yes, so family members. So it's a more social reason. So it is only the noise that we are concerned about. So that is primary snoring. So whether a patient goes for treatment or not, it really doesn't matter, as long as the spouse is comfortable. Now, snoring with sleep apnea is serious. So what I would advise for this patient is first go in for a simple sleep study. That is one night monitoring of sleep, which is also called polysomnography. It happens inside the sleep lab in any hospital, or you can opt for a home sleep study as well. So once one night sleep study is done and we get the record, it's 1,000-page data, and then we draw inferences from that. We would see how many times there's oxygen falling every 1 hour, what is the lowest oxygen saturation. Like normally 98 to 100% is expected all night sleep. But if the oxygen drops to 80 or 50 or 60, depending upon the severity of the disease, we would come to know. So there are various statistics that we see on the sleep study and polysomnography, and then decide how severe the sleep apnea is. So all snorers, please go for a sleep study and make sure you're not suffering from sleep apnea. Now the other question.
The sleep apnea surgery success rate.
Well, I'll tell you, there are a lot of factors that we look into. One is the BMI. BMI below 40 is very important for a promising cure. And second is the levels of obstruction. Now, mild, and after the sleep study, once we categorize whether it's mild sleep apnea or moderate sleep apnea or severe sleep apnea, even in severe, we have early sleep apnea or critical sleep apnea. To tell this patient, mild and moderate sleep apnea with good BMI, they do very well. Yes, we're able to cure these patients. We're even able to give them very good quality of life. We're able to, compare the sleep studies and show them the results. There was, we're getting a lot of patients with interesting feedbacks and testimonials. You know, some of them should see what feedback patients have given us, both national and international. With the advent of robot, we've had very successful sleep apnea surgeries.
Okay, that's interesting. There's a simple question, but I think it's important for many. Sai Shivani is asking this question. I feel tremendous pain on both sides of forehead during cold nights. It also gets blocked. I have to take a breathe by mouth. Any different kind of contour pillow? Any kind of contour pillow help?
Well, see, again, now this could be a contact area headache or a sinus headache. So she needs to definitely go and see an ENT surgeon, get a nasal endoscopy done, and we will definitely, and then there is a small test in the outpatient, which we call it a CENTA study. It's called selective intranasal topical anesthesia study, which means if he or she is suffering from headache, please go and see the doctor at the time of suffering from the headache. Then we, put a cotton wool soaked with anesthetic inside the nose in that particular area, which we call, sensitive area. And then if the patient has had relief of the headache after this, putting this cotton wool, that means it is nose or sinus related. And then, yes, so we confirm, because whether the headache is due to migraine or whether it is due to nose or sinuses, it's after performing this CINTA study. So nasal endoscopy and CINTA study will let us know whether it is nose related. And then definitely she can be cured.
This is again an insight, ma'am. Very, very, we don't know. We keep suffering from stuff. We hesitate to go to a doctor, especially a specialist that you would want to. And these are the platforms that Apollo 24/7 have created. Every week we get to ask these questions, which otherwise you would avoid.
Absolutely. Actually, it's a myth. A lot of people think snoring is, snoring happens only in healthy individuals. And snoring, people who snore are very happy people. It's a myth, actually. Snoring should never be ignored. And similarly, all these small little things, what you're saying, ma'am, is like, people think ENT is all about just cold and cough and sneezing. It's not so true. ENT is such a wide spectrum, dealing from minor ailments to severe ailments. There are, innumerable disorders that people can't even imagine.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, there's this Sean David's question. Is there any way of avoiding minimizing wax formation in the ears? And what's the best way to de-wax the ears?
Okay. Now, first of all, I'll have to tell people that, wax is all related to genetics. Some people, produce wax predominantly on one side. Like, some people have always wax collection on the right side and some people on the left side. And similarly, color of the wax, some people produce, brown or lighter brown color. Some have darker brown color. Wax is basically for good protection. So having wax is not a bad thing. It'll protect you from ear diseases. Now, what is the best way to de-wax is, first of all, my simple advice is not to use cotton buds. A lot of people use cotton buds and try to remove the wax. Where a little comes out and rest of it gets pushed inside, that's one thing. Second thing is, you are actually disturbing the nature self-cleansing mechanism. So people who are in the habit of cotton buds will always tend to have impacted buds. And the best method is, well, you can use some D-wax drops, and if it doesn't work, then of course the ENT doctors, we're going to remove it through vacuum suction clearance. We don't use water and syringes anymore.
Acha, you don't use them anymore. This is
vacuum suction is the best, safest.
Yes, that's what we used to hear earlier. But what is the new way, ma'am?
Vacuum suctioning. Like, you know, it's painless and the negative pressure draws the wax.
Ah, that's interesting. Thank you again. Ma'am, Sharath Boppana's question, does breathing problem elevate your blood pressure, BP?
Yes, very much. Like snoring and sleep apnea patients have hypertension, most of them. And, you know, interestingly, all the patients that we have been treating, at least, 80% of hypertensive people, meaning people who have had hypertension and sleep apnea, who were cured of sleep apnea, interestingly told us that they're off antihypertensive pills. They're not taking their medicines for hypertension anymore. So they are obviously related. Otherwise, also sleep apnea is linked to hypertension, diabetes, altered cholesterol levels. They have increased risk of heart attacks, brain strokes, and cancers.
Yeah. And a quick hello to you from a lot of your followers, ma'am. They're thanking you for the support that you've rendered. Rosie Ahuja, MJ Nayak, Manoj Sinha, Saumya, Sudhir, and a lot of them are sending you hello through the platform.
Thank you all so much. Namaste, Vanakkam, Sat Sri Akal, and Jambo. You know,
yes.
There's a lot of people from, I think, you know, various walks of life. So I wanted to greet everyone.
Yes. Uma Shankar Vula is asking this question. Hi, ma'am. Sometimes I get ear pain in both ears, and when I clean the ear.
So, what in both ears?
Ear pain.
Okay.
In both ears. When I clean, I'm trying to understand the question and put it in proper way. I suppose he bleeds from both the ears while he cleans it, and then it's a headache. I'm suffering from many ears. Uma Shankar Vula, I think it's a Telugu person. Have you? I don't know. Evarna ENT chupincharandi, chupiste quickga naaku kinda okasari chat box lo type chesi pampinchandi. The issue is that he has pain.
Diagnosis teliste easy ga ayipothundi.
Correct. So Uma garu kudirthe kanaka maaku message pettandi. Yes, ma'am. But what is it, ma'am? If somebody cleans and there is blood, what does it mean?
Well, the skin inside the ear canal is actually very delicate. So trauma is causing the bleeding. Ear bleeding, one doesn't have to worry. There's only one condition which is called glomus tumor. You know, there's glomus jugular, which can be present in the ear, and that can cause also ear bleeding. But it's kind of rare. But common, most of the times it's due to trauma. As she said, ear cleaning. So the cleaning itself is injuring the skin, and that's where there's bleeding. So nothing to worry.
Oh, nothing to worry about it. All right. Yeah. Ma'am, this is Manish Singh's question. I snore and I got a sleep study done. Sleep index 33, OSA, uncomfortable with the CPAP. Will pranayam help me?
Oh, no. He's got already severe sleep apnea. About 30, that is 33 AHI, is supposed to be severe sleep apnea. He has that much risk of developing heart disease and strokes, etc. So please be serious about it. Do come for treatment. Pranayam is just, it will make you feel good, but it's not going to cure your sleep apnea. So you can continue with your pranayam, but you still have to come and address, get your sleep apnea addressed.
Right, ma'am. Ma'am, I think next is Unnam Rama Rao. What is the medication for sinus headache? I think we've spoken about it. Sharon Paul, ma'am, is there any treatment for PNS and sore throat? Is there a connection between the PNS and sore throat?
Yes. People who are having this drip, constant post-nasal drip, meaning drip from behind the nose, which keeps coming into the throat, that keeps trickling from the backside of the throat, and that keeps irritating the throat, and that can cause sore throat. So a patient with chronic sinusitis can also have recurrent sore throats. So PND definitely has to be taken care.
Okay. So is that
definitely linked, and it can be treated.
All right. Wonderful. Is there any treatment for tinnitus? And there are a lot of questions on tinnitus. Arpan Chatterjee is asking this question, and I also have seen few of them asking about tinnitus.
Yeah, actually, you know, a lot many people who are suffering from tinnitus get a big prescription, you know, like, you know, there are multiple medications mentioned and unfortunately they don't improve and they're going from pillar to post, seeing many doctors. They end up in depression also. There are a lot of people who are suffering from tinnitus who are unable to sleep even. Yes, I want to tell all these patients who are suffering from tinnitus, we have newer solutions. There are some medications like Metadol, which has amino acids in it, like taurine, and that is helping some people with tinnitus. Apart from that, we have new solutions like called tinnitus matching and masking. We actually, you know, map this tinnitus on internet, and then we get matching solutions by giving them a small device that they need to wear, and the device will help them mask that sound. And some of them, there was this patient from Ethiopia who was into severe depression because of this tinnitus for more than 20 years. And he's so much thankful now that he's now, you know, literally cured of it, except that he has to wear a small device. So, but he's very happy he went back with it because it got completely masked.
Okay. Mr. Ashok Talwar, I don't have persistent cold or sneezing problem yet during my sleep. Nose, particularly on the left side, gets blocked and mouth breathing starts, which causes dryness in the mouth, throat, which is disturbing. Kindly advise why it happens, treatments and precautions or preventions if possible. There is no nasal bone diversion observed by an ENT names.
Yes. Right. Mouth breathing is not normal, you know, because normally what happens, we get humidified air. The nose is like an AC, air conditioned chamber. So the air we inhale, it gets humidified inside the nose. So people who do not breathe through nose and keep their mouth open, because this is a nature's way of breathing, you know, people, this is a spontaneous, a corrective mechanism. Anybody who has a blocked nose, automatically nature has devised this method of keeping the mouth open and taking the air inside the mouth. But that air is not humidified air. And so that's dry air and it causes dryness in the throat. So again, as I said, his valve, whether it is nasal valve is normal or not, it's again checked by a simple test called Cottle's test. And other than that, we do an endoscopic examination. So we need to know the underlying cause for the blockage and correct it. Once it's corrected, then he will not breathe through mouth anymore.
Okay.
So end of solution.
Yes. Lalita's question is that I feel something in my head is moving. Ears are very dry and are always itching. Is it anything related to serious
Yes, dry and itchy is a very common problem, nothing to worry. Actually, some people have less wax production. If you see them even at 50 years of age and their ears are absolutely clean and they've never had any need to get their ears clean, which means they've never had wax production. In such cases, they have dry ears. So we just advise some little home remedies like, you know, olive oil, etc. They can heat it and bring it to room temperature and then use it. So it's really nothing to worry. But I want to tell something for these people. Some of them have great relief when they use cotton buds or hair pins, etc. Because, you know, when it's itchy and when they do that, it gives them good pleasure. And that becomes a habit forming
habit.
Yes, yes. Because it's like a vicious cycle, you know. The more
then you damage.
Yes. And it also leads to a condition called neurodermatitis, where the patient is in this persistent habitual cleaning pattern going on every day, and that causes some kind of ulceration inside the canal. And so that is why people should stop using the cotton bud or anything that they are introducing for pleasure. And automatically some of them, if I tell them please stop using it for the next 2 months and you'll see the problem will go away, it actually vanishes.
Very interesting. Ma'am, there are two questions regarding sinusitis. One, Galaxy Group and Lalita GS. One is sinusitis wale har roz wash kar sakte hai kya? How frequently is it related? And second question is, due to sinusitis, can he lose the hearing ability or will it affect the hearing?
Yes, sinusitis can affect the hearing. There are two types of hearing loss, which we call conductive loss and sensorineural loss. Conductive loss is something due to the middle ear. Now, they can be fluid in the ear. So people who have sinusitis, they can have eustachian tube blockage. So there's a block, tube between the nose and the ear, which can get blocked. Now, that can cause negative pressure in the ear and that can cause, you know, excess secretion of the mucous glands. And so there can be fluid collecting in the ears. So that can be a reason. Yes, they are interlinked. And similarly, there's no need of daily washing of the nose. Well, some people practice yoga. I tell them, fine, if you're okay with it. I mean, there's nothing, no, it's not going to cause any harm. But these irrigations are required most often only when there is a patient suffering from cold or after some sinus surgery. Then we give them a recommended duration, and there is a recipe for that. It's not like you can use X amount of salt or soda in that and then use for it, because it irritates the lining of the nose.
All right. The question was about washing the hair, ma'am.
Washing the hair every day.
And with sinus.
Okay. Yeah, a lot of people think it is because of washing the hair and all that. Well, you know, some people have this allergies to hair colors, etc. But just washing hair doesn't lead to sinusitis. There is no such relation. Well, they can develop. Yeah, it depends on the temperature difference, etc. Because, you know, viruses thrive on cold. So if if it's a acute winter and if you're washing your hair early morning, yes, then you can have a viral cold or a cold leading to sinusitis. Yeah, so, you know, you can suit yourself, be washing them at comfortable, temperature levels, etc. Otherwise, there's no direct relation.
Yes. Ma'am, 18-year-old son hai inka. He's getting headache, neck pain and eye pain whenever he's trained. Do I have to go and visit an ENT?
Whenever he's training, meaning?
He's training. That's the only thing that I have. Maybe study or...
training or something? Because... Train meaning?
Not the train, ma'am. Strain. Stress and strain.
Oh, stress and strain. Yeah, got it. Yes, well, one ENT examination is definitely required. Now, there are several causes for headache. They can be neurological causes. They can be eye-related causes. They can be nose and sinus-related causes. They can be cervical-related causes. So one needs to definitely go to somebody. You can go to a physician or an ENT doctor or a neurologist. Depends. And finally, yes, you have to get your ENT also evaluated if that is the reason. But stress per se can cause headache.
Right. Ma'am, daughter's 8-year-old takes breath from mouth, not from the nose, mostly during sleep too. But she does not take any deep sleep. I'm worried. Is this a serious problem? Please guide me.
Yes. Now, there is one condition called adenoids in children. You know, it's on the backside of the nose. It's the type of tonsil. And when they get enlarged, it obstructs the breathing passage. So the air goes from the front of the nose, but it's not able to go from backside of the nose because there is a large tissue sitting there. So it is enlarged adenoids, we call it. And this is a condition which most parents miss. So children with mouth breathing need to come to us to get themselves evaluated. Enlarged adenoids can even affect the growth. So these adenoids, there's a certain grading. Grade 1 and grade 2 can do well with medications. Grade 3 and grade 4 adenoids, they need to get them removed. It's only a daycare surgery and it has to be removed. Otherwise, it can cause problems, yes.
Sure. Ashwini is asking this question. What are the preventive health tests that can be done for early identification of ENT-related conditions?
Yes. One is, it depends upon the comorbidities. If a patient has, supposing plus 40 or 50 years of age, and you have hypertension, diabetes, altered cholesterol, or one episode of MI or anything like that, please go for evaluation of snoring and sleep apnea. Now, similarly, if a patient is elderly, plus 60, do go for your hearing evaluation every year. Because your hearing could be gradually declining. At least we'll know your baseline levels. So similarly, there can be other, if you're a smoker, you please do come and get your throat checked. If you're a tobacco chewer or, any kind of risk factors that you already have, do come and get yourself checked. We could be doing an endoscopic examination to see for conditions like leukoplakia. Leukoplakia is a precancerous condition. So these are white lesions or patches, or erythroplakia, those are red lesions which are more risk than leukoplakia. So these kind of things only your ENT doctor can find out and tell you, well, you have the risk, you already have a precancerous condition. So please take care, come every, few months to get it checked or get it removed if it is, if it's any of these. So it depends on the risk factors and the comorbidities and the age group. And I would advise, yes, regular screening. If you're on anti-tuberculous drugs, you're taking treatment for TB, it could affect your hearing. So again, get your baseline levels checked. And similarly, if you're a diabetic, please get your nose and throat checked, and even ears. And similarly, if you're suffering from asthma, do make sure that you do not have nasal polyps, because upper airway and the lower airway are connected. Most people with asthma and fungal infections in the chest, they have something in the nose. They have a disease in the nose, and it's missed most often. So here in our hospital, when pulmonologists refer us cases, and that's how then they discover, yes, they have an additional disease there. And when the upper compartment gets treated, the lower compartment gets better automatically. Their asthma improves once the nose condition gets treated.
Wonderful, ma'am. This is almost like a summing up one-minuter that you could give with an advice. Ma'am, next question is, how does one differentiate between a headache that is caused by sinus or a stress or any other reason for headache? Is there a difference of identifying a sinus headache?
Absolutely. Starting from history. Now, history of sinus headaches will be different from other headaches. It's like bending forwards and the time of the day, it's worse in the afternoons, etc. Apart from that, apart from the history, a simple endoscopic examination will tell you whether it's sinus related or not. And the test that we performed, as I mentioned earlier, center study. So these tests will let us know if it is sinus related or not. And, interestingly, I have to tell you something. There was this Assamese girl and there was this Nepalese girl. Both of them were put on migraine medications for many, many years. And they both had sinus headaches, actually, and it was nothing to do with migraine. And they got completely cured once their sinus headaches were taken care of. So sometimes there is a confusion in the diagnosis. So the diagnosis is ultimately, that's the most important thing. If you arrive at the right diagnosis, then you get the right treatment. So yes, please, stress related or whether it is migraine related, there could be any other cause. So it is all the specialist that is going to be identifying and telling you what is the exact cause for headache.
Right, ma'am. Ma'am, Lalitamba's question, I'm not sure if this comes to you, but pertaining to you, but Lalita having Hashimoto's thyroid and gland not yet got surgery, acid reflux, having too much of headache, what is the solution?
For Hashimoto's thyroiditis, it's most often medical treatment. Very rarely surgical treatment is required. So nothing to worry at all. I would suggest she should just go to an endocrinologist and get it. For thyroid problems, actually, you have medical conditions and surgical conditions. There are diseases where there are thyroid nodules or thyroid tumors. That's when a surgeon is required. Otherwise, an endocrinologist takes care of it, as in her case.
Okay. Ma'am, next question. I don't know if you are pertinent person to answer this, but sleep apnea procedure requiring assessment and overnight stay covered by insurance? Anushka Harish is asking this question.
Yes, there are certain corporates that cover for this. And similarly, there are very few insurance companies that cover for this. All the international companies cover for the sleep apnea study. Even Max Bupa covers for it. And as I said, ONGC, NTPC, etc., the corporates cover it. But unfortunately, there are many other insurance companies in India that they don't cover for sleep study. Despite being a very serious illness, people have to address, we have to write to the government, we have to write to the health ministry asking them to actually cover for the sleep apnea study. So most of them who come to me also for snoring and sleep apnea, except for corporate patients, they're having to pay from their pocket for sleep study. Yes, it's a very important point and it has to be addressed at the government level and all the heads of the insurance companies that, yes, please cover for the sleep apnea study. After all, it's a serious illness.
It is, ma'am. Thank you so much for taking this question. Ma'am, Arpan Chatterjee, I've got an operation of cyst on pituitary gland through nose. After that operation, I'm not able to smell anything. How do you suggest?
Well, after transsphenoidal, pituitary surgery, that is, we remove the pituitary tumor through the nose, loss of smell is a very rare complication, doesn't even happen. He could have lost his smell otherwise because of some viral illness after the surgery. It is not directly due to the surgery. So viral illnesses, unfortunately, even COVID, post-COVID, a lot of people have lost smell. And usually it is temporary, but sometimes it could be permanent, unfortunately. But it's nothing to do with the surgery.
Yes, yes. Ma'am, there are a lot of questions regarding sinus and sleep apnea. I think you have been talking about them, so I don't want to repeat the questions. There are many more questions which have come up, very active engagement from all the participants. But unfortunately, I'll have to wind up for today. Thank you so much for your time. But before we close, I want to thank you for the patience and energy and the love that you have.
Thank you so much, and thanks for being an excellent host.
Thank you so much, ma'am. So before we leave, can we have quick tips of taking care of ENT issues?
Yes. So my final summary again would be, first of all, eliminate all your risk factors. You know, stop smoking, stop drinking, don't chew tobacco, sleep well. Sleep hygiene is also very important. So anything, do not self-medicate. Over-the-counter medications are easily available, like Otrivin, Nasivion, etc. Please do not medicate yourself. You please consult a specialist if you have nasal obstruction. And similarly, do not ignore your snoring. Do not ignore your tinnitus. Do not ignore mouth ulcers. Do not ignore smell disorders. There are several disorders which can, these symptoms could be part of a sinister disorder. So do not ignore your health.
Wonderful, ma'am. Thank you. And now I understand why you have so many fans. Thank you once again.
Thank you, ma'am.
Pleasure having you on the show.
You too. Thank you.
Yes, as we are running short of time, I'm coming up with the health quiz. Three questions I'm going to ask you. You can type the answer in the chat box, and the winners will be announced towards the end of the show. We will announce, and you have to write back if you are the winner with your contact details at marketing@apollo247.com, and the gift vouchers will be shared with you. Get ready. Question number one of health quiz today. Which body part cannot heal itself? Question again. Which body part in a human body cannot heal itself? Question मैंने दो बार बोल दिया है. Going to question number two. Please type the answer in the chat box. Let me see who the winner is. Which is the largest organ in the human body? Which is the largest organ in the human body? That is question number two. अरे बाबा, संध्या सिंह thinks that heart is the body part that cannot heal itself. Ear, nose, skin. Also type which question, your question number one, question number two. Which answer you're typing. Which body part cannot heal itself? Abhi mujhe answer aaya nahi hai, wo question ka sahi answer, I mean to say, nahi aaya hai. Question number two, which is the largest organ in the human body? Not by weight. That's a clue. Which is the largest organ in the human body? Not the heaviest organ. Somebody has typed liver, isliye maine bola. Ashwini B, one is teeth, correct. One nose, no. Liver, no. ठीक है, क्वेश्चन नंबर टू का भी सही आंसर नहीं आया है. इफ यू वांट टू गूगल, प्लीज कम एंड टाइप द आंसर अगेन. व्हिच इज द लार्जेस्ट ऑर्गन इन द ह्यूमन बॉडी? गॉड्स विल एम, स्किन बोला है, दैट्स द राइट आंसर. एंड थर्ड क्वेश्चन, व्हिच इज द इंट्रोडक्टरी, सॉरी, व्हाट इज द इंट्रोडक्टरी फीस ऑफ 2 month सर्कल मेंबरशिप प्लान ऑफ अपोलो 24/7? व्हाट इज द इंट्रोडक्टरी फीस ऑफ 2 month सर्कल मेंबरशिप प्लान of Apollo 247. Bahut hi simple hai. I also mentioned this on the show. That's the question number three. I want to repeat and close. What is the introductory fees of 2 month circle membership plan? 49 Vishwanath Agarwal, and that's it. I'm going to wait for the winner's announcement. But before that, it is a Sunday, and circle members, you can experience a super Sunday, especially for circle members. You can buy medicines today, anytime, and you can get an Apollo hand sanitizer, which is worth rupees 100 at no cost. And use this code AHSSUN and you can get this 200 ml of hand sanitizer worth 100 rupees totally at no cost. That's wonderful. Thank you so much for participating. And winners, winners, winners. Let's see who the winners are. Ashwini B, God's Will and Vishwanath Agarwal, congratulations. Please write back to us, marketing@apollo247.com, and claim your gift. Thank you so much, all of you, for joining. Here are the gift coupons. You can use Apollo 247 and get up to rupees 299 off on online consultation with Apollo doctors. And use Medicine 10 to get 10% off on pharmacy orders. Log on to Apollo 247 app to use the coupons. Thank you so much once again, all of you, to have participating and making it such an engaging discussion. We would love your feedback. Please write to us and share your feedback at Apollo marketing@apollo247.com. Thank you so much, all of you, once again. See you next week.